Greetings and blessed day to you once again, people of God, is the Revelator once again. And hoping the grace and mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ is with you until the end of time. Now, before we enter into yet another classic, I just want to give you a brief recap of what we covered last time. Last time, we officially entered into the season 2 of the realms and dimensions in the spirit. We are coming from season 1, where several presentations we presented in part 1, and we entered into season 2, and we opened season 2 with a presentation in which I revealed the dream dimension and explained about the realm of dreams. And also inside that presentation, we exploded into altering destinies in the spirit. And today we want to enter into the realms and dimensions season 2, which is now heading to part 9. And inside part 9, we want to focus on the revelation dimension, which is now part 9. And inside the revelation dimension, we want to explode and unbundle the realm of predictions. We are going to be evaluating the spirit of revelation, how it functions and how it operates and its creativity. So, child of God, like as usual, I want you to walk with me in spirit as the Holy Spirit will be explaining this whole presentation, which is the revelation dimension, part 9, the realm of predictions. Our emphasis is going to be on the ability of determining fate, or the ability of determining events in the spirit. Earlier on, we explained about the ability of altering destinies. Let us get into scriptures. In the book of Daniel, chapter 2, verse 1. And in the second year of the reign of King Nebuchadnezzar, Nebuchadnezzar dreamt dreams wherewith his spirit was troubled. The kings of old were troubled by dreams. They are not like the kings of this time. They are not like the presidents that we have of this time. They are not like the leaders that we have of this time, who do not worry about dreams. In other words, what I'm trying to say is that they don't worry about spiritual things. As long as they are sitting on the throne, they only worry about spiritual things when they realize that power is about to get wrestled, and they want to be rescued by spiritual men. And Nebuchadnezzar is seated on the throne. As powerful as he is, he has been troubled by dreams. Then the king commanded to call the magicians, the astrologers, the sorcerers, and the Chaldeans to show the king his dreams. So they came and stood before the king. And the king said unto them, I have dreamt a dream, and my spirit was troubled to know the dream. Then spake the Chaldeans unto the king, saying, O king, live forever. Tell the servants the dream, so that we might know the interpretation. Then the king answered to the Chaldeans, saying, the thing is already gone from me. If you will not make known the dream unto me with the interpretation thereof, you will be cut in pieces, and your house shall be made in dunghill. Now, I need you to understand something. It was always the case that if the king had a dream, the Chaldeans, the magicians, the astrologers, the soothsayers, they would come in and they would interpret the dream. They would speak their minds, their ideologies upon a dream which the king would have had. But this time, it's a different case. the king had a dream, but the king has forgotten that dream. And what is now required is a man that does not only interpret the dream, a man that knows the dream which the king had without the king telling him. In so many instances, I have managed to interpret a dream before a dream has been told unto me. And in many instant cases, I'm able to give the interpretation of the dream which someone is not released unto me, which will cause the one that has had the dream to release the dream after I have already given the interpretation. And the king has threatened that if this dream is not made known unto him, that is category number one. The king has threatened that if this dream is not interpreted after having been made known unto him. Can you imagine? This is a demand from the one that had the dream, and he has forgotten the dream, and he wants them to know the dream first. After knowing the dream, he wants them to interpret the dream. After interpreting the dream, he wants them to tell the king what the dream means. Then in Daniel chapter 2 verse 6, and the king says, but if you show me the dream and the interpretation thereof, you shall receive of my gifts and rewards and great honor. Therefore, show me the dream and the interpretation thereof. They answered again and said, let the king tell his servants the dream, so that you can show you the interpretation. The magicians, the astrologers, continued to wrestle with the king and said, no. Tell us the dream first. There is no way we can interpret a dream without you telling us the dream. How can we interpret a dream without you telling us the dream? They continued. The king answered and said, I know of certainly that you would gain the time because you see the thing is gone from me. But if you will not make known unto me the dream, there is but one decree for you. For you have prepared lying and corrupt ways to speak before me. Till the time be changed, therefore tell me the dream. The king insisted. And I shall know that you can show me the interpretation after you have told me the dream. The ideology of the king is that there is no way you can give me the interpretation if you don't know the dream. If you don't have a record of knowing things without anyone telling you, how then do you get the knowledge of interpreting what has been provided for you? You must first have the ability of revealing what you have never been told, what you have never heard. And after you have revealed it, then we can trust you with our dreams. There are so many that are now in the business of trying to interpret dreams, but they've never revealed a single thing. So how do you interpret what has been provided when you fail to reveal what you have never been told? The child has answered before the king and said, there is no man upon the earth that can show the king's matter. Therefore, there is no king, lord, ruler, or any rank in the spirit that can ask such things at the magicians or astrologers, including the Chaldeans. And it is a rare thing that the king requires. And in this instant case, they continued speaking. And there is none other than anyone that can show it before the king, except the gods, whose dwelling is not with the flesh. For this cause, the king became more angry and was furious and commanded to destroy all the wise men of Babylon. I need you to understand something here. The king wants to go to the level of wanting to destroy all the wise men, the astrologers, the magicians, the Chaldeans, just because he is insisting them to know the dream that he has forgotten. I explained earlier how in this generation we don't have kings, presidents, or any rulers that are so concerned with spiritual things like this king. And though Nebuchadnezzar was not a totally upright ruler who ruled on behalf of God, though he had his heirs, but it must show you the generation of kingship that was there during that era. It is not compared to the kingship. For this cause, the king became more angry. Why? Because there was no one that could break the dream and bring the interpretation. And the decree went forth that the wise men should be slain, and they sought Daniel and his fellows to be slain. Now, here's the mystery where the whole presentation begins. When the king says he wants to destroy all the wise men, the astrologers, the magicians, the soothsayers, and all other spiritual operating wise men, in those categories, there is Daniel. And Daniel is a God-fearing servant of God. In Daniel chapter 2, verse 14, then Daniel answered with counsel and wisdom to Arioch, the captain of the king's guard. Arioch is the one that had been sent to kill with his army all the wise men for failing to reveal what the king had dreamt. And this thing, remember, it had already gone out of the mind of the king. He answered and said to Arioch, the king's captain, why is the decree so hasty from the king? Then Arioch made the thing known to Daniel. Then Daniel went in and desired of the king that he would give him time, that he would show the king the interpretation. Then Daniel went to his house and made this thing known to Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. These three were Daniel's partners in prayer and intercession. They were only three men: Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. He entered with these three into a time of prayer, into a time of intercession. Daniel did not gather 100 people to say, let's pray before the king can destroy us. No, he only collected three. And they went into prayer. They went into fasting. They tapped into the realm of revelation dimension. And when they tapped into the revelation of dimensions, into the dimensions of revelations, the thing was made known unto Daniel in a vision. And Daniel told Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, his partners, to get into a moment of spiritual devotion, so that they would not perish with the rest of the wise men of Babylon. Then was the secret revealed unto Daniel in a night vision. Then Daniel blessed the God of heaven. Daniel answered and said, blessed be the name of the Lord forever, for wisdom and might are his. And he changes the times and the seasons. And he removeth kings and sets up kings. He giveth wisdom unto the wise and knowledge unto them that know understanding. He revealeth the deep and the secret things, all the mysteries and revelations. Local, if you read, it's written revealing the deeper mysteries of God. And I'm presenting the revelation dimension. There are levels in the spirit that don't require scripture. There are levels in the spirit that require revelation. And the astrologers, the magicians, the soothsayers, the Chaldeans, they are about to get killed. And Daniel taps into a revelation dimension. It's actually a dimension. Why? Because it's not everyone that is seen in that dimension. It's just a few who are custodians of that dimension. You can't enter into the realm of revelation dimension if you are not a custodian of revelation, like the revelator. We have a custodian of revelation in scripture, who is John the Revelator, and we have Daniel, and we have Joseph. Those three, they were custodians of dimensions, in interpretations, in dreams, and in revelations. And this revelation dimension, Daniel is the partaker who has entered in a revelation dimension after intercession, and the secret has been made known unto him by God. Remember, the Chaldeans, the astrologers, the magicians, the soothsayers, and many of them with the lying spirits, they have convinced the king that no one can know this issue unless that person be a god. In other words, they were declaring Daniel as a god. And Daniel went and stood before the king. But before Daniel stands before the king, Arioch, the captain, goes and insists to the king that I found a man who can crack the mystery of the dream that you forgot. He does not only crack the mystery of the dream that you forgot, he will also interpret that dream. And he will reveal the deeper mystery of the meaning of that dream. I'm talking about the revelation dimension. The king answered and said to Daniel, as he stood, whose name was Belshazzar, are you able to make known unto me the dream which I have seen and the interpretation thereof? And Daniel answered in the presence of the king and said, the secret which the king has demanded, cannot the wise men, the astrologers, the magicians, the soothsayers show the king? As Daniel was just provoking the king, he's asking, I always see you with astrologers, with the soothsayers. They are the ones that eat on your table. How come they cannot interpret this matter unto you? There is a level of revealing international and national matters, whilst you have those that are called senior prophets in a nation. And it baffles many why someone like Samuel the Revelator can pick deep things in the spirit which the so-called senior prophets are not picking. And this is the same case. Daniel, you do not find Daniel in the king's court. Daniel is far away there with his team. They are always praying. They are behind the scenes. The real men of the spirit, they are always behind the scenes. The real men of the spirit, they are not trending. They are very scarce. And then the king said, can you make known unto me, O Daniel, not only the interpretation, but reveal unto me what I dreamt? And Daniel says, there is a God in heaven that revealeth the secrets. This is no longer an issue of interpreting. Interpretation is when you interpret what has already been provided. You are either interpreting parables, you are interpreting writings. At one time, Daniel interpreted writings over the wall. Interpretation is when you actually wait for someone to say a dream. Then you interpret. But when it comes to revelation, it's speaking things that no one has seen or heard. Nothing that is written. We are not talking about those that are good at interpreting scriptures. No, we are not talking about the revelation dimension. And then Daniel enters into the revelation dimension. And when Daniel enters into the revelation dimension, he begins by cracking the dream which the king had. O king, your thoughts came into thy mind upon thy page. He does not begin by telling the king the dream that he forgot. He begins way before you even forgot that dream. What level of revelation is this? He tells the king the genesis of what triggered and provoked that dream. What provoked that dream were the thoughts of the king, which then provoked and triggered the dream that he forgot. And then Daniel says, thy dream and visions of thy head upon thy page, What you saw in your vision is what is yet to come. He briefly gives the king an interpretation. And, O king, what you saw and behold was a great image. The great image, whose brightness was excellent, stood before you, and the form thereof was terrible. The image's head, the image and its head was of fine gold, his breast and his arms of silver, his belly and his thighs of brass, his legs of iron, his feet part of the iron and part of the clay. This is Daniel defining a dream, not explaining the interpretation. You saw till that a stone was cut out without hands, which smote the image upon his feet and were of iron and clay, and break them to pieces. Then was the iron, the clay, the brass, the silver, and the gold broken to pieces together, and became like the chaff of the summer threshing floors, and the wind carried them away, that no place was found for them. And the stone that smote the image became a great mountain filled with the whole earth. This is the dream. And now I will tell you the interpretation. Daniel has explained in detail the meaning of, not the meaning of the dream. He has explained the dream. Now he wants to explain the interpretation of the dream. We are going to enter into the last category, which is the meaning of the dream, which describes the revelation dimension. I said there are three categories: knowing the dream, interpreting the dream, and knowing the meaning of the dream. Those three are not the same. And it begins with the interpretation. O king, at King of Kings, he begins by honoring the king. For God of heaven has given you kingdom, power, strength, and glory. And wheresoever children of men dwell, the beasts of the field and the fowls of heaven have given into thy hand, and has made you ruler over them. Thou art this head of gold. He's interpreting every part that he explained, which the king never told him, even not the dream. After thee shall arise another kingdom inferior to you, and another third kingdom of grace, which shall bear rule over all earth. And the fourth kingdom shall be strong as iron, for as much as iron breaketh in pieces and subdueth all things, and as iron that breaketh all these shall it break into pieces and bruise. And whereas thou sawest the feet and the toes, the part of potter's clay and the part of iron, and the kingdom shall be divided, and there shall be in it of the strength of the iron. For as much as thou sawest all this, there is a meaning. And as the toes of the feet were part of iron, the part of clay, so the kingdom shall be partly strong and partly broken. And whereas you saw iron mixed with the mere clay, and they shall mingle themselves with the seed of men, but they shall not cleave one to another, and they shall put division, even as iron is not mixed with clay. And in the days of these kings shall be the God of heaven set up a kingdom, which shall never be destroyed, and the kingdom shall not be left to other people, but it shall break into pieces and consume all other kingdoms, and it shall stand forever. For as much as you sawest all this, that the stone was cut out of the mountain without hands, and that it break into pieces, the iron, the brass, the clay, the silver, the gold, the great, God made known to the king what shall come to pass here and after, and the dream is certain, and the interpretation thereof. Then the king Nebuchadnezzar fell upon his face and worshipped Daniel. Remember, the astrologers, the soothsayers, the magicians earlier said, no man can make known the king the dream that he had, including the interpretation and the meaning, unless he be a god. And the king understands that there is no one that can know all this unless he be a god. What it means is that when Daniel was explaining this dream, the king's memory was coming back. He started remembering the dream by being told by another man. That is not a level of interpreting. That is beyond a dream dimension. That is a revelation dimension. The king answered unto Daniel and said, of a truth it is, Your God is a God of gods and a Lord of kings and the revealer. And the revealer. And the revealer of secrets, saying that you could reveal all these secrets. Then the king made Daniel a great man and gave him many gifts and made him a ruler over all the province of Babylon and the chief governors over all the wise men of Babylon. Then Daniel requested of the king and he set Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego over all the affairs of the province of Babylon. And Daniel sat in the gate of the king. Now, I want you to understand something. Daniel was able not only to know the dream which the king had, he was able to interpret the dream. He was able to describe the meaning of the dream, which signified a division in the kingdom, a chaos in the kingdom, which was yet to come. And Daniel reaches a point of sitting on the throne. But when Daniel sits on the throne, he collects three of his disciples, three of his partners that he was in intercession with, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And he appoints them as governors. We are not talking about one who, when the heaven has chosen him, he starts dining with the kings of the earth. Daniel remembers that they are three loyal disciples. Daniel remembers that they are three loyal disciples. And he sets them over the realm. And they rule. And Daniel sat on the gate of the king. Child of God, I'm here to reveal the dream dimension. Not just the dream dimension, but the revelation dimension. I'm here to unleash an ability that is beyond interpretation. An ability that is beyond explaining what has been explained unto you. A revelation dimension that is beyond reading scriptures. A revelation dimension that determines fate. A revelation dimension that decides events. A revelation dimension that predicts what has never been heard. A revelation dimension that predicts what has never been spoken. And as Daniel was able to know the deeper secrets, I'm here to release the spirit of revelation, the spirit that makes known the deeper mysteries of God. I pray that you are given the ability, the creativity of the spirit of revelation. I'm talking about the revelation dimension, the realm of predictions, in the name of Jesus.